in life for free. But you can give them to the birds and bees. I want money. Thrill. But your love won't pay my bills. I want money. That's what I want. That's what I want. That's what I want. Don't get everything, it's true. What it don't get, I can't use. I want money.
Good evening. My name is Sal Yurick, and by way of what I do, I'm a writer and a sometimes critic. And tonight we're going to conduct an interview with a new magazine called The New Criterion. Before that, I want to welcome you all to the new postmodern age and the kinds of changes that we are seeing wrought in our society, not the least of which is the comeback again after a long absence of a lot of hunger in the streets, the rise of the CIA once more, the National Security Agency monitoring all your phones, the use once again of literature, art as propaganda, but with a new mix. Let me fill you in on a little bit of the background of this. In 1967, there were some tremendous revelations about the CIA. Among other things, the usual stuff of assassinations and torture and all that kind of thing. They were involved very much in high art. They were involved in painting. They were involved in high-class literature. They funneled money through all kinds of foundations. The foundations gave it to other foundations. It poured into magazines. It came to places ultimately like the Partisan Review. It went to publishers. And I should say also that they were not alone in this. Along with that was the State Department and the United States Information Agency, which made sure that it stocked books of certain kinds of propagandistic value, but not in a narrow sense, all over the world, so that people in the third world, for example, could be acclimated to Western thought. Western thought has a certain kind of trajectory, and the trajectory we usually think of it is going from the Greeks to the Romans, and from the Romans into the Middle Ages, and from the Middle Ages into the modern period, the Industrial Revolution, so forth and so on, all with its own accompanying form of art. And all along the way, the pundits, the critics, would pick and choose what would constitute, as it were, the great canon of art and literature. Well, a terrible thing happened in the 60s. We had a revolution, or whatever that was. I mean, a tremendous uprising and a challenging of all standards. And to answer this whole kind of thing, some people got together, namely Hilton Kramer, who was the art critic for the New York Times. And what Hilton Kramer decided is that standards had declined so terribly that what he was going to do is he was going to put out a new magazine, and that new magazine was The New Criterion. Pretty, a little bit dull, a little bit stodgy, but, you know, essentially this is what it's going to be about. And we're going to go through this magazine and we're going to look at it a little bit and see what kinds of things they favor and what kinds of attacks they make. I want to show you a picture of Hilton Kramer. Here is Hilton Kramer, right? Here's Hilton Kramer looking over modern art and finding a lot of it not to his taste at all. There's a look of a turning away, you notice, a little look of disgust on his face. Right? Okay, let's get to this thing. First, like any magazine should, he gives us a note on the new Criterion. Where did he get the title? There was a magazine once called the Criterion. Right? The Criterion was edited at one point in time by T.S. Eliot. This was at back, I believe, in the 1920s. Right? Think about T.S. Eliot and the people who always liked T.S. Eliot is that, I mean, I find it odd because we have here praises of T.S. Eliot like Hilton Kramer, Joseph Epstein, Norman Podhoretz, people like that. What's always odd about that, what's always struck me a little bit funny, is that T.S. Eliot was a virulent anti-Semite. Right? Some of it comes through in his poetry, but he wrote for church papers. He hated Jews. I don't know why a certain subset of the Jewish community finds him so interesting, except for the possible radicalness of his art on the one hand and the conservatism of his opinions. Now, what I like to ask of the magazine is, you know, why did you do this, right? And they give you the answer in the first note, right? They quote Walter Scott when he put out the Quarterly Review, and what they say is the real reason for instituting the new publication is the disgusting and deleterious doctrines with which the most popular of our reviews disgraces its pages. This, you will find, just applies to almost everything around. Now, what are they fighting against? Now, the editors tell us we are still living in the aftermath of the insidious assault on mind that was one of the most repulsive features of the radical movement of the 60s. That's pretty heavy. The cultural consequences of this leftward turn in our political life have been far graver than is commonly supposed. Now, this is peculiar because the movement itself was so vast and so inchoate, made up of so many elements that could be considered as right-wing, left-wing, people who were apolitical but involved in an entirely different lifestyle, and yet what they have done is to take that whole movement and encapsulate it as a leftward move, which is a little peculiar, right? Now, again, what they're doing constantly is that they deplore the politicization of art in the 60s and in the past. They used to tell us when I went to school in the 50s that the best art does not have politics. Best art itself is the best politics you can have. Now, one of the things that the editors inform us is that many writers on the left, and this includes a good many of our prominent critics too, have never forgiven history for failing to conform to the fictions of radical prophecy. They have never forgiven American society for failing to live up to their critique of it. In some tender sanctum of the soul, socialism remains their moral and social ideal, but a socialism so immune to historical contingency and moral reality that is now indistinguishable from a religious dogma. Most of the writers that I know, essentially leftist writers, really don't think that way. They are adjusting all the time to conditions. More than that, there are so many forms of left that you would be hard-pressed to find one particular outlook on that. And they conclude by telling us in this note, it is therefore all the more urgent that a dissenting critical voice be heard, and it is for this the purpose of providing such a voice that a new criterion has been created. Now, you will find that this is a very heavy political magazine, that it is against so many things that it is positively, well, what shall I say, it is misanthropic in its approach. To pass to the next step, one of the first articles in here is something called The Literary Life Today by Joseph Epstein. And Mr. Epstein is also discontented, malcontent, unhappy with so many forms of literature that emerged, for instance, in the 60s, if not before. He tells us that at one point in time there was a literary community to be found. You could find it in Paris, you could find it in London, and you could find it, for that matter, in the United States, mostly in New York and Boston. Right? What has happened is that it has fragmented, it has dispersed in so many different directions that there is no longer a community. It is to be found in the university. Mr. Epstein does not like university-based art. He does not like painters who paint for academic critics. He does not like writers who write for the academy. And so he lays about him in a variety of directions and attacks so many writers that, you know, I won't go through all of them. But he does talk about one thing, the English department novel. And he picks out for this, written by such writers as Jonathan Baumbach and Ronald Sukenik, and at its higher reaches, John Barth. Well, that sinks them. He goes on, and he doesn't, he stops for a second, pausing only to sink semiotics and structuralism. I don't know that I have any real quarrel with that. And he says that what he dislikes especially is the kind of writing that belongs to a particular ethnic or sexual group. He says that there was one point in time that one did not consider literature if it was written by a Jew, a woman, a black, a homosexual. Right? I should say that mostly the trend is very, very heavily anti-gay in this, not so much in this magazine, but in other articles these people have written. Their complaint, for example, about the difference between modern literature and literature of the past is that their preoccupations have been political, not literary. Communism, the Cold War, the Third World, the kind of society America is or ought to be, these are among the subjects that have used up so much of the intellectual oxygen of the past quarter century. However, when we consider, what do we think Dickens was writing about? Dickens had a whole variety of political options. He did politics through his books. Dostoevsky's whole thing was to struggle against the introduction of Western ideas to the East. Dostoevsky wrote his novels, which were, in a sense, on the one hand, political novels, and on the other hand, detective novels, very much from a political stance. Right? Now, then he goes down to the question of the political writer, particularly, the ones he hates. Right? And for contrast, he gives us Orwell, Camus, Salon, and Malraux, all from the, writing from the position of the 30s and maybe into the 40s. These are the heroes. Epstein tells us that Malraux, each of them lived at a time of great political passion. Each was himself political in the most serious way. But the literary intellectuals they wrote on political subject, but as literary intellectuals they wrote on political subjects with the authority of literature behind them. In the United States today, things tend to run the other way around. Then he attacks such novelists as Robert Coover, E.L. Doctorow, and Robert Stone create literature with the authority of politics behind them. For them, the novelist politics by other means. Well, knowing some of these people, I don't know that this is really strictly so. I mean, Robert Coover, for instance, has only written one novel that can be narrowly categorized, if you want to distort the novel, that's The Public Burning, as political, because it's partly about the Rosenbergs. But what is he after? He's really after the whole question of American mythology. Robert Stone, as far as I know about Robert Stone's work, and from Robert Stone himself, does not consider himself a political. Right? And Doctorow swings sometimes in that direction and other times not. Now, he goes on to say, if one disagrees with Doctorow's politics, the pleasure is drained from his novels. In other words, if you do not believe that the Rosenbergs were innocent or that Henry Ford was ridiculous, you are excluded. Well, I'll come back and talk about that in a little bit.
In life for free, but you can give them to the birds and bees. I want money. That's what I want. Your love gives me such a thrill, but your love won't pay my bills. I want money.
All right.
get everything, it's true. What it don't get, I can't use. I want money.
Okay, now coming back to this, it strikes me that a critical reading of Dr. Rowe's work does not plant him in any one camp or another. He is criticizing, in fact, the whole of the United States, which I think in the form of literature, which is what Dr. Rowe writes, is not a doctrinaire attack. He is showing history in a sense, in a scrambled sense, of the way it is. One can read Dr. Rowe's book of Daniel with any kind of interpretation one wants and really be impressed by that literary quality. One does not have to accept the fact that the Rosenbergs are innocent or not innocent. One can argue with that. To go a little further, the fact of the matter is that this terribly powerful man, Henry Ford, was in fact ridiculous, and he was very dangerous, and he was very fascistic minded, and to attack Henry Ford is not to attack God. Now, we then have a perhaps one of the whole centerpieces of the whole thing, and that is an essay on postmodern art and culture in the 1980s. And you have been seeing a whole question of what categorizes what in terms of art, as you've seen these postcards, these pictures being put in one category or another. The whole question of categories is up for grabs. There is a certain kind of art, it is clear, that Hilton Kramer does not like at all. And that kind of art he would characterize perhaps as socialist realist, Stalinist, leftist. But so many things come into this. The decline of standards is the constant lament in this thing. I might point out and say that, for example, that this kind of art is really not the kind of art you want to do, because why? It shows somebody who is clearly a worker. You don't want that. More than that, the worker seems to have something like breasts. So that's like a double sin. I forgot to show you a picture of Joseph Epstein. This is Joseph Epstein clutching his head at the terrible qualities that literature has descended to in our modern period. Now, I would recommend this reading because he attacks camp, he attacks Susan Sontag, he attacks all kinds of trends, he attacks pop art, and he points out that, in fact, postmodern is not a step forward in some way, but a step back, going back to a time when perhaps, though I don't know what time that was in American history, when the eternal verities of art existed, when there were things that you thought you could put your finger on and you could say, here are standards, here is the best, here is the worst, here is kitsch, here is schlock, here is grand art, so forth and so on. So what we're seeing is the emergence of a whole trend of criticism in this, in which the standards are going to be reset. Another piece that I think bears real reading is a question, this is a reevaluation of F.R. Leavis by Norman Potthoritz. Now I ask you, in this day and age, aside from 20 people who are heavy scholars, who has heard of F.R. Leavis, or for that matter, who cares about F.R. Leavis? Now this is a man who is hailed on the one hand as a great critic. On the other hand, there's a little quarrel that Potthoritz, who is a curmudgeon of the worst type, has with F.R. Leavis. And that quarrel is that, if anything, aside from his literary judgments, F.R. Leavis was a man who, in a sense, was anti the modern period, anti-technical Benthamite thinking. Now, all a Luddite, in other words, now all Luddites are, that's bad news, right? Now, the complaint about F.R. Leavis is he didn't recognize, in some sense, who his children in the 60s were. But if you take all the people in the 60s and lump them into one, then what have you got? I mean, there were people who were revolting against standards who were, in fact, were techies, phone freaks, computer freaks, right, who saw a new age dawning. The movement was so vast that you couldn't encompass it that way. But what has happened is that in using this retrospective about F.R. Leavis, Potthoritz has worked his political point, right? Anti-Luddism, Luddism is bad, smashing of machines is bad, this society is great, and this is the kind of theme that's worked throughout the whole thing. Again, the question is really one ultimately of standards and the restoration of standards, which will emerge as issue after issue of this dreary, dreary operation continues to unfold. I might say the writing in this is simplistic, and rather that F.R. Leavis makes, in which he is called a great critic, indicates that the man is indeed not a great critic, but a dogmatic fool. Right? His mode of criticism is, these works are great because I tell you they are great, and it's obvious from the works itself, which is no way of doing criticism. Finally, one last thing. There is a review of a book by Simone de Beauvoir, and this book is about the last day of Jean-Paul Sartre. And what happens in this is a very interesting kind of thing. Jean-Paul Sartre was sick. Jean-Paul Sartre was also attracted to some of the more radical elements on the left, Maoists, people like that. In the implication of the way the whole thing is worked is that obviously Jean-Paul Sartre's politics must be tainted. In fact, his whole work must be tainted because he was sick at that point. He had a variety of diseases. He was dying. He could not have been very clear in what he wanted politically out of life at all. And they take this, a retrospective discussion of what has taken place of his life, and they use it to destroy Sartre. Now, Sartre used to be the darling of these people. Sartre is no longer the darling of these people at all. Right. Finally, I think what I'd like to show you is the picture of what they are going to do. And here it is. Here it is. What we have over here is the restoration of standards, the restoration of hierarchy. Here we have, over here, right, we have Norman Potthoritz. Beneath that, we have clutched in his hands, we have Hilton Kramer, and above that, the American Eagle. And to the side, you notice, because these people are really very sexist, we have standing there Midge Dector, Mr. Potthoritz's wife. So, and this, I think, is what they want for us all. Right. If you're curious yourself, what I would suggest is go out and buy this. $350 is a little heavy for such a thin magazine, printed in big type, with such egregious opinions. But if you want to do it and see what's happening, I would do that. I should say also this magazine is heavily backed by foundations, so they really don't have to struggle for existence. The foundations are for the most part right-wing. It's a wretched production. On the other hand, a lot of people, unfortunately, are going to be quoting this. And with that, I guess that wraps it up. Thank you very much. Sitting there yakking right in my face, I guess I'm gonna have to put you in your place. You know, if silence was golden, you couldn't raise a dime.
because your mind is on vacation and your mouth is working overtime. You quoting figures and dropping names. You telling stories about the days. You over laughing when things ain't funny. You trying to sound like the big money. You know if talk was criminal, you would lead a life of crime. Because your man is on vacation and your mouth is working overtime. Short, talk is cheap. Don't be making promises that you can't keep. You don't like this little song I'm singing, just grinning back. All I can say is if the shoe fits a wet and you must keep talking, please try to make it rhyme.